Section 6.4, Local Area Networks, starting with Addressing and Address Resolution Protocol. It is well known that the IP address, or what we call the network layer address or layer 3 address, is mainly used to forward IP datagrams from source to destination. So if we add an IP datagram to be forwarded from source node A to destination node B along a path consisting of 3 routers, and let us call the first router R1, the second router R2, and the third router R3, then the IP datagram will be forwarded from source to destination based on the IP destination address. However, the frame which encapsulates the IP datagram at the data link layer will be forwarded along the path from one node to another based on the MAC addresses of these nodes. For example, in the first stage, the frame will be forwarded from A to R1 based on the MAC addresses of A and R1. In the second stage, the frame will be forwarded from R1 to R2 based on the MAC addresses of R1 and R2. And in the third stage, the frame will be forwarded based on the MAC addresses of R2 and R3. And finally, the frame will be forwarded from R3 to B based on the MAC addresses of R3 and B. The MAC address is also called the LAN address, or the physical address, or the Ethernet address. And to re-emphasize, the main function of the MAC address is to get frame from one interface to another physically connected interface. The MAC address is a 48-bit address that is burned into the network interface card read-only memory. However, sometimes it is software settable. And here we have an example of a MAC address, which is again 48-bit address, which is equivalent to 6 bytes. The address here is represented in hexadecimal notation, where each byte is represented using 2 hex digits. Therefore, to convert from hexadecimal notation to binary format, we convert each hex digit into a 4-bit binary value. For example, the first byte, which is 1A, can be converted to binary by converting 1 to binary as follows, which is 0001, and converting A into binary value to be 1010. And therefore, this represents the binary format of the first byte of the MAC address. The second byte, which is 2F, is converted to binary by converting 2 into 0010 and converting F into 111, and therefore obtaining the binary representation of the second byte, and so on. Now, within a local area network, each network adapter, or what we call network interface card, has a unique MAC address. The MAC address allocation is mainly administered by IEEE organization, where network interface card manufacturer buys portion of the MAC address space, and this is to assure uniqueness. Network interface card, which could be manufactured by, for example, by Intel, or by Dell, or by Cisco, just to name a few manufacturers or few vendors. Each of these vendors will obtain or buy portion of the MAC address space from IEEE organization. بمعنى أنه IEEE organization will allocate certain number of bits for each vendor. So this will be specified by IEEE for Intel. Another sequence of bits will be specified by IEEE for Dell, and so on. And the remaining part for each vendor will be specified by the vendor itself. Now, any host in a computer network will have an IP address, as we know, which is a layer 3 address, and a MAC address, which is layer 2 address. And again, the MAC address is built into the read-only memory of the network interface card. The MAC address is considered to be a flat address, therefore it is portable, meaning that we can move the host from one network to another network without changing the MAC address. The MAC address remains the same. However, the IP address is hierarchical, therefore it is not portable, meaning that if we move the host, and of course moving the network interface card, which is more important, then the IP address should be consistent with the configuration of the new network. Therefore, if we move host, for example, from network A, which has subnet ID 120.30.40 /24 to network B, which has subnet ID 140.22.50/24. Then we have to change the IP address of the host as it moves from A to B to be consistent with the subnet ID of B. Having an IP address and having a MAC address for a host is similar to having a postal address and a social security number for a human being. Now, how to determine interface's MAC address knowing its IP address? It's important here to mention that if we went to transmit a datagram from host A, for example, to host B, and we know the IP address of host B, then we have to encapsulate the IP datagram within a frame that contains the MAC address of A, which we already know, and the MAC address of host B, which we don't know initially. Therefore, A will use the address resolution protocol to obtain the MAC address of host B. And this is done using the ARB request message. ARB request is a broadcast message sent by the host A to all other nodes in the network, asking about the MAC address of the host that has IP address 137.196.7.88. Now, host B will reply back with a unicast ARB reply message containing the MAC address of host B. I have to mention here that each node in the network has what is called ARB table. It is a table with three columns that provide mapping between IP addresses and MAC addresses, and there is expiration time for each entry in the table. Therefore, we have three main columns. We have the IP address, we have the MAC address, and we have the TTL value, which is kind of expiration time for each entry in the table. Initially, the table is empty. However, as a result of the reply message that we obtained from host B, host A will add to the table the IP address of host B, which is 137.196.7.88 in this example, and the MAC address of host B, which is received within the ARB reply, which is again in this example 0C up to 98. And TTL value such that the entry will expire after some time. Maybe this is going to be valid for 20 minutes or 40 minutes. It depends on the configuration. I have to mention that the ARB protocol is a plug and play protocol. There is no special configuration and there is no intervention by the administrator to initialize the ARB protocol. Whenever a node is going to transmit a frame and the destination MAC address is not known, it has to issue an ARB request, which is again a broadcast request. By broadcast, I mean the destination MAC address in the request message is going to be all ones. All ones, we are talking about in hexadecimal notation, FF six times, 6 bytes of ones. Therefore, our table where each IP node, either host or router on LAN, has a table. The table provides IP to MAC address mapping for some LAN nodes. And this is the mapping provided. Again, the IP address to MAC address, and there is TTL, which represents an expiration time for each entry in the table. Here we just list the main steps performed by node A to obtain the MAC address of node B, as I illustrated in the previous example. A went to send datagram to B. B's MAC address not in A's ARB table. Therefore, A broadcast ARB query bucket containing B's IP address. The destination MAC address is all ones, which is in hexadecimal FF, like shown here. All nodes on the LAN receive the ARB reply. However, B receives the ARB bucket replies to A within its B's MAC address. and therefore this is the frame sent to A's MAC address in a unicast message. Upon receiving the ARP reply message, A caches the IP to MAC address pair in its ARP table until information becomes old based on the expiration time specified in the message. Again, we emphasize that ARP is blank and blear, meaning that nodes create their ARP table without intervention from NIT administrator. Let us now consider a more generic example of forwarding an IP datagram from source node A to destination node B, where B is located in a different network. And let us focus on the addressing at the IP layer, or what we call the network layer, and addressing at the MAC layer, or what we call the data link layer. Here we assume that A knows the IP address of node B, which is provided here. It also knows about the IP address of the first hub router. It is the IP address assigned for the network adapter of the router from this side. This is called the first hub router. Or the default gateway. Of course, it is the default gateway and the first hub router for node A and for the other node in this network. Let us call it node C. And node A learns about the IP address of the first hub router from the DHCP server. Recall that when node A joins the network, it obtains an IP address from the DHCP server in addition to the address or the IP address of the first hub router and the IP address of the DNS server. Also, we assume that node A knows about the MAC address of the router network adapter from this side. And of course, A learns about the MAC address of the router from this side using the address resolution protocol that we just discussed. Now, forwarding the IP datagram from node A to node B will be done in two stages. In the first stage, the IP datagram will be encapsulated within an Ethernet frame and forwarded from node A to the router. In the second stage, the IP datagram will be forwarded within another Ethernet frame and forwarded from the router to the other node or the final node, which is node B. And this is shown here, where the IP datagram, which includes the IP source address that is equal to the address of node B, and the IP destination address, which is equal to the IP address of node B. This datagram will be encapsulated within an Ethernet frame that include the MAC source address of node A and the MAC destination address that is equal to the destination or to the MAC address of the network adapter of the router from this side, which is starting with E6 and ending with 4B. Then the frame is going to be forwarded from A to R. The router will decapsulate the frame and obtain the IP datagram. Then, based on the IP destination address, it will decide to forward the datagram along this interface. And since B is in the same network, it will include the MAC address of node B in the Ethernet frame to be forwarded from the router to node B. Therefore, we will encapsulate the IP datagram within an Ethernet frame, and the header of this Ethernet frame will include the MAC source address of the network adapter of the router from this side, which is starting with 1A and ending with 9B, to be the source MAC address. And the address of B, or the MAC address of B, to be the destination MAC address, which is starting with 49 and ending with 2A. And then forwarding the frame from R to B. Here I emphasize that the IP source and destination addresses remain the same from beginning to end. What changes mainly are the MAC addresses from one node to another. In the first stage, we use the MAC addresses of node A and the MAC address of the network adapter of the router from this side. And in the second stage, we used the MAC address of the router network adapter from this side and the MAC address of node B. Now, regarding Ethernet, Ethernet is a dominant wired LAN technology implemented on a single chip and provides multiple speeds. It is among the first widely used LAN technologies. It is characterized by its simplicity and low cost. Ethernet, in fact, kept up with speed race. Initially, it provided a rate of 1 megabit per second, then 2 megabit per second. Along the line, provided 10 megabit per second, then 100 megabit per second. And recently, it provided 1 gigabit per second. And currently, it provides 10 giga and even 100 gigabit per second. Ethernet has two main physical topologies, the bus topology and the star topology. The bus topology is the old-fashioned topology where all nodes are in the same collision domain, where a coaxial cable is shared among all nodes in the network, and mainly each host connect to the coaxial cable, which is considered the shared medium or shared channel, using special connectors. And we know that the main problem of such topology is that if there is or if there are two or more hosts transmitting, then their signals will interfere with each other, and that would result in a collision. However, in the star topology, which is a commonly used topology and the one that is common these days, we have an active Ethernet switch in the center, and each host is connected separately to one of the physical ports of the switch using an Ethernet cable. So, therefore, there is no single collision domain. Here is the Ethernet frame structure. The headers added by Ethernet to the IP datagram includes the following fields: the preamble field, the destination MAC address, the source MAC address, and the type field. In addition to a trailer that represent the CRC field for error detection. Preamble is mainly a 7 bytes with the pattern alternating 1010, followed by 1 byte with a specific pattern, which is 10101011. It is mainly used to synchronize receiver and sender clock rates. Therefore, the sender starts by adding the preamble, which is again 7 bytes of alternating ones and zeros, which is something like this. We are talking about 7 bytes, byte 1, byte 2, up to byte 7, then followed by a byte with special pattern that has the following bit sequence: 1010, 1011. The main purpose of this preamble is to synchronize receiver and sender clock rates. Regarding addresses, source and destination, each is a 6-byte address. If an adapter receives frame with the matching destination address or with a broadcast address, which is all ones, it will pass the data in frame to the network layer protocol. Otherwise, the adapter discards the frame. The type field indicates the higher layer protocol. In most cases, we are dealing with IP layer and IP protocol. However, there are other possible types, including novel IPX and AppleTalk. And the last field, which is the trailer, is the CRC field, which is the cyclic redundancy check at the receiver. And if an error is detected, the frame is dropped. Ethernet is unreliable connectionless protocol. Connectionless meaning that there is no handshaking between sending and receiving network interface cards. Unreliable in the sense that receiving network interface card doesn't send acknowledgements or negative acknowledgements to the sending network interface card. Data in dropped frames recovered only if initial sender uses higher layer reliable data transfer, such as TCP, otherwise dropped data got lost. And the Ethernet's MAC protocol is the unslotted carrier sense multiple access with collision detection with binary backoff, the one that we discussed earlier when we talked about medium access protocols. And there are many different Ethernet standards, and the common medium access control protocol and frame format with different speeds, as we mentioned earlier, ranging from 2 megabit per second, 10 megabit per second, up to 10 and 40 and even 100 gigabit per second. And there are different physical layer possible implementations, including fiber and cable. Here are specific Ethernet standards with different physical layer media, whether it is copper or fiber. Switches and virtual LANs. Now hosts within local area networks are connected to each other using Ethernet switches. A host with a network interface card is connected to the switch using an Ethernet cable that connects the network interface card of the host to one of the physical ports of the switch, or what we call the switch interface. Now, the number of hosts within a local area network that can be supported by certain switch depends on the number of switch interfaces. For example, a switch with six interfaces can support six hosts, starting with host one, and we can have five other interfaces and therefore five other hosts from host two to host six. This is going to be host three, host four, and host five. And here the switch plays an active role as a link layer device or data link layer device, or what we call layer two device. It is mainly a store and forward device. A frame that is for received by the switch will be forwarded selectively to one or more outgoing interfaces of the switch based on the destination MAC address found in the Ethernet frame. And here link access is mainly based on carrier sense multiple access with collision detection algorithm. And the switch is considered as a transparent device with respect to hosts in the network, meaning that hosts are unaware of presence of switches. They operate mainly based on the carrier sense multiple access with collision detection algorithm. It is also a plug and play device with self-learning property, which means that switches do not need to be configured and there is no special configuration by network administrator for these devices. And in fact, switches provide the ability of multiple simultaneous transmissions in the network. For example, if there is a frame to be transferred from host A to host A bar in a local area network, and another frame is to be forwarded simultaneously in the same time from B to B bar, then this can be achieved simply in this topology by forwarding the frame from A to A bar through the switch interface number one in the first stage, from A to the switch through interface number one, and from the switch to A bar through interface number four of the switch. At the same time, the other frame can be forwarded at the same time from B to the switch via interface two of the switch, and from the switch to B bar through interface number five of the switch, without having any collision or interference between the two frames, because each link represents a single collision domain. There is no chance of having colliding frames in this scenario. Also, it is possible to send another frame from C, for example, to C prime without having any problem, because again, there is separation between collision domains in this case. Now, the switch is able to forward the frame to A bar if it knows that A bar is reachable via interface 4. And if it knows that the other frame is going to be forwarded to B bar if it knows that B bar is located or reachable via interface 5. This can be achieved using the switch table, which is available at the switch. The switch table is a table maintained by the switch, which is similar to the routing table in a router. It is mainly a table that provides mapping between MAC addresses of hosts or devices in the network and switch interfaces where each device is located. There is three main columns for this table. There is the MAC address column, there is the switch interface number, and there is a timestamp, or what we call TTL value, which specifies the expiration time for each entry in the table. This table is initially empty and got populated through the self-learning property of the switch, as we illustrate in the following example. Here we consider the same example of forwarding a frame from A to A bar. Therefore, the frame contains A as the source MAC address and A bar as the destination MAC address. The switch table is initially empty, as we just mentioned, and the frame is going to be sent from A to the switch via interface 1. Therefore, the switch learns that MAC address A is available at interface 1 or reachable through interface 1, and it adds the timestamp or the TTL value of 60 in this example. And since the switch does not have any information yet about the reachability of A bar, as we can see here, there is no information about A bar yet, it will perform frame flooding to all other interfaces. As we just saw, the frame was flooded to or through interface 2 and interface 3, interface 4, interface 5, and interface 6. And this will ensure that the frame would reach its destination. Now, if a frame is to be forwarded from A bar to A, then the MAC address of the frame will be A bar and the destination address will be A. And the frame will be sent directly from A bar to the switch. And here the switch learns that A bar is reachable via interface number 4 because the frame was received through interface number 4. And therefore, a new entry is added in the table indicating that A bar is available or reachable via interface 4. And of course, it will add the TTL value similar to the previous case. Now, since the frame is going to be sent to node A, and the switch knows that A is reachable via interface 1, there is no need to flood the frame again to all other nodes in the network. The frame will be selectively forwarded to node A through interface 1. And this is called selective forwarding or selective sending of the frame to the final destination. Here, we emphasize that we have two main processes here. We have flood process. If we don't know the location of the destination MAC address, then the switch will flood the frame to all other interfaces. And the other issue is the selective forwarding, in the case the switch knows through the information available in its switch table where to forward the frame based on the information again available in the switching table or the switch table, as we called it previously. Now, it is possible to have multiple switches interconnected with each other in case we have large network. And let us consider this scenario where we have a group of machines or hosts connected to switch number 1, and there is another group connected to switch 2, and third group connected to switch number 3. And the three groups are connected all together using switch 4 by connecting again S1, S2, and S3 all together using switch number 4. And let us assume that we need to send a frame from host A to host G. And here A and G represent the MAC addresses of A of these two hosts. Therefore, a frame is to be forwarded again from A to G. And before illustrating the forwarding process, let me assign numbers for each switch interfaces. For example, S1 has four interfaces. Let us number them like this. This is interface number 2, this is interface number 1, this is number 2, this is number 3, and this is number 4. For switch number 2, let us name them or assign them these numbers. This is 1, this is 2, this is 3, and this is 4. For switch number 3, let us call this interface number 1, this is interface number 2, this is interface number 3, and this is interface number 4. And finally, for switch 4, let us assign number 1 for this interface, number 2 for this interface, and number 3 for this interface. And now the frame again is to be forwarded from A to G. Therefore, A will send the frame to switch number 1. And by receiving this frame, switch number 1 will update its switch table by adding the following entry. It will add A as MAC address and 1 as the switch interface where the frame is received, in addition to the TTL value. Let us just focus on the MAC address and the switch interface. Since it does not have any information about G, where it is located, it will flood all other interfaces, which are in this case interface number 4 and interface number 3 and interface number 2. So the frame will be sent to the 3 or along the 3 interfaces. Switch number 4 will receive copy of the frame. Again, we are talking about the frame containing A as the MAC address, the source MAC address, and G as the destination MAC address. Therefore, the frame will be forwarded through the remaining interfaces, which are interface number 2 and interface number 3. And before that, it will update its table by adding A as the MAC address and 1 as the switch interface, because the switch, I mean here switch 4, learned that A is available or reachable through interface 1 of this switch. Therefore, we add this mapping between A and interface 1. Now, switch 2, when receiving the frame containing A as the MAC address and G as the destination address, and since it does not have any information yet about either A or G, it will learn that A is available through interface 4 of switch 2. Therefore, it will add this mapping, and it will flood all other interfaces with the frame. Similar thing for switch number 3. Switch number 3 will receive the frame from switch number 4. Here it will update its switch table by adding an entry for MAC address A, which is available or reachable via interface 4 of switch 3. Then, since it does not have any information about G yet, it will forward the frame to all other interfaces. It is the flood process, as we mentioned earlier. This will ensure that the frame will eventually reach the destination node, which is node G. Now, assume that G has a frame to send to A back. Then the frame will contain G as the source MAC address and A as the destination MAC address. And the frame will be sent to S3 initially. And therefore, S3 will update its switch table by adding an entry for G and indicating that G is available through interface 1 of switch 3. Therefore, we will add number 1 as the interface number where G is located. And since we have an entry for A, we know that this frame is going to A, and there is an entry already in the table indicating that A is available through interface 4 of this switch, then there is no need for frame flooding. We just perform selective forwarding through interface 4. Therefore, we send the frame back containing G as the source address and A as the destination MAC address. When received by switch number 4, again, switch number 4 will update its switch table by including G as a new entry and the interface through which the frame was received, which is interface number 3, which means that G is available through interface 3 of switch 4. And again, since the frame is forwarded or is going to go to destination A, and we already have an entry for A indicating that A is available through interface 1 of switch 4, then we perform selective forwarding from switch 4 to switch 1 through interface 1. And finally, switch 1, by receiving this frame, again, which contains G as the source address and A as the destination address, it will update its forwarding table or its switch table by including G as the MAC address and 4 as the switch interface. And finally, since we know the location of host A or MAC address A, which is behind interface 1, we can perform selective forwarding of the frame to the final destination. From this example, we show how is the self-learning process is performed by different switches in the network. Again, whenever we receive a frame, we learn the location of the MAC address, the source MAC address of the frame, and we update the switch table by adding an entry that maps the MAC address and the switch interface where the again where the frame was received. We can also perform similar thing by considering another scenario here. For example, suppose C sends a frame to I and then I responds to C. Here is C and here is I. It is gonna be exactly the same scenario with the minimal difference of considering the switch interface where C is located with respect to S1 and where I is located with respect to S3. I will leave this as an exercise for you, and you can go through this exercise easily the same way we performed the previous example. Now, if we consider an institutional network, a network for a campus or a university, a university obtains internet service from an internet service provider. Therefore, we usually have a fiber link connecting the network campus to the external network or the external internet, and this will reach the default gateway or default router of the campus. Internal network structure will contain one or more distribution switches, which represent main switches in the campus data center. Part of the campus network will be a zone special for public services such as web servers, mail servers, FTP servers, usually in a special network segment known as demilitarized zone or known as DMZ. And then from the distribution switch, we have connections to what we call access switches, which are available or provide network service to different departments and colleges in the university. For example, this can be for the CS department, this can be for the network engineering department, this can be for computer engineering department. And again, these are hosts located either in labs or in offices or in classrooms. And this design can be expanded to accommodate a large number of machines within a campus network. We have also to compare or to talk about the differences between switches and routers. In fact, both are store and forward devices. Okay, however, routers are network layer devices, mainly examine network layer headers, work on IP datagrams, while switches are link layer devices, which mainly examine link layer headers. And both have forwarding tables, as we saw in previous sections. However, routers compute tables using routing algorithms such as distance vector algorithms or the Kistra's algorithm and perform forwarding based on IP addresses, while switches learn forwarding, perform self-learning to update their forwarding tables or what we call switch tables, and perform forwarding based on link layer addresses, mainly destination MAC addresses. Now we discuss the topic of VLANs, or what we call virtual local area networks, and here we consider the scenario of an institutional network containing network segments for computer science department, for electrical engineering department, and for computer engineering department. Now this network in its current configuration represents a single broadcast domain in the sense that if a frame is to be forwarded from host A in the computer science department to host B in the computer engineering department, then this frame, which contains A as the source MAC address and B as the destination MAC address, will be forwarded to the first switch, which is the switch in the computer science department. The switch will then broadcast the frame to all other interfaces in a way similar to the example that we just discussed about a network consisting of multiple switches interconnected with each other. The distribution switch will then broadcast the frame to the other two switches, the electrical engineering switch and the computer engineering switch, and both will broadcast the frame to all end systems connected to them. And as we can see here, the frame will be at the end broadcasted to all end systems in the network. And this in fact represents a major issue in terms of efficiency and performance, and in terms of security and privacy. In terms of efficiency and performance, because it represents a huge traffic overhead, especially if the network size is very large, then the frame will be forwarded to all end systems in the network. Also, in terms of security and privacy, because any end system can sniff the frame sent from A to B. For example, an end system in the electrical engineering department can sniff the frame and obtain copy of the frame and inspect its content. Another issue, if a user in one network, for example, a user in the computer science department moves office to electrical engineering department and therefore get connected to the switch in this department, in the electrical engineering department, then we don't have full control over the computer science department traffic. The traffic exchanged between users in the computer science department can be viewed or can be sniffed by a user in the electrical engineering department. To overcome these issues, virtual LANs were designed and introduced where switches supporting VLAN capabilities can be configured to define multiple VLAN or virtual LANs over single physical LAN infrastructure. Here we have single physical switch with 16 port numbers. This can be configured to support two or more VLANs. In this example, we are considering two VLANs by dividing the port numbers into two groups and assigning each group to one VLAN. For example, the group of port numbers from 1 to 8, which are shown in the blue color, are assigned to hosts in the electrical engineering and therefore providing support mainly for the electrical engineering VLAN, while the other group, which is shown in the yellow color, which mainly contains port numbers from 9 to 16 or includes port numbers from 9 to 16, are mainly assigned for the computer science VLAN. Here, the single physical switch operates as multiple virtual switch. It is exactly as we have two separate switches, one for electrical engineering and one for computer science. This configuration provides what we call traffic isolation, meaning that we ensure frames to and from ports 1 to 8 can only reach ports 1 to 8. Here it is to be mentioned that VLANs can be defined based on the MAC addresses of end systems rather than port numbers of the switch. For example, if we have end systems with MAC addresses, let us call them MAC address 1, MAC address 2, up to MAC address 8, we can group them in one group and define one VLAN. Similarly, we can group MAC addresses in the other VLAN and define a VLAN for computer science department. Let us go back to the issue of defining VLANs based on port numbers. VLANs provide the ability or has a feature of dynamic membership. For example, we can add this port number to the group of port numbers assigned for computer science VLAN, and therefore extending the VLAN of the computer science to include, in addition to the port numbers from 9 to 16, to include port number 3, for example. Therefore, it is possible or to add another port number. For example, port number, if we call this 4, this is 5, this is 6. For example, 6 to be added also to the computer science VLAN. So there is a lot of flexibility in configuring VLANs, adding and removing ports from each group to support more hosts or to move hosts from one VLAN to another VLAN. Now, forwarding between one VLAN to another is done via a router. This router can be a separate physical router or can be a built-in router in the same switch. In fact, most vendors sell combined switches plus routers. The VLAN switch or the switch that supports VLAN or with VLAN capabilities has a built-in router that provide forwarding between one VLAN and another. It is also possible to have VLANs spanning multiple switches, multiple physical switches here, I mean. For example, we can define two VLANs using two physical switches by defining, for example, the port numbers that belong to the first VLAN. In this example, port numbers 1 through 8 and from the first switch, and port numbers 2, 3, 5 from the second switch represent one virtual LAN, while port numbers 9 through 15 on the first switch and port numbers 4 to 8 on the second switch represent another VLAN. Here, in order to forward traffic between VLANs, we need to have what is called trunk port. In this example, port 16 is connected to port 1, or port 16, the first switch, is connected to port 1 on the second switch to carry frames between VLANs defined over multiple physical switches. And here, frames forwarded within VLAN between switches cannot be just regular 802.1 frames, and therefore a new standard has been defined, which is called 802.1Q, which adds and removed additional header fields for frame forwarded between trunk ports. Here we show the frame format. This is the original Ethernet frame 802.11, containing the preamble, the destination MAC address, the source MAC address, the type, and the data, which is the payload, and finally the cyclic redundancy check field. In the new standard 802.1Q frame, there is a 2-byte tag protocol identifier, and there is also tag control information, which is 12-bit VLAN ID field, and there is a 3-bit priority field, which are similar to IP type of service field to give priority to frames when forwarded from one VLAN to another. Section 6.5, link virtualization using MPLS, multi-protocol label switching. Here we provide generic overview about multi-protocol label switching networks without going into their details. The initial goal of MPLS networks is to provide high-speed IP forwarding using fixed linked label instead of IP address. We know that in IP routing, packet forwarding is based on IP destination address. However, in MPLS networks, packet forwarding is based on fixed linked label, or what we call fixed linked identifier. And this provides a fast lookup because there is no need to perform shortest or longest prefix matching. The idea of using fixed length identifier in MPLS networks is similar to that used in virtual circuit approach that we discussed in chapter 1. However, here IP datagram still keeps the IP address, as shown in the general frame format of the data link layer frame, which includes the header, which could be Ethernet header or point-to-point protocol header, followed by the MPLS header, which includes 4 fields, which are the label, a 20-bit field, then 3-bit for experimental use, and 1S-bit, and 5-bits for the TTL field. The MPLS header is followed by the IP header, and of course the IP header will include the IP source address and the IP destination address, and then the remainder of the link layer frame. A router that supports MPLS networking is called MPLS capable router, or it is called the label switched router. Label switched router forward packets to outgoing interfaces based on label value. We have MPLS router or label switched router with several outgoing interfaces, then an incoming datagram will be forwarded along one of these interfaces based on the label value instead of the IP destination address. And this provides flexibility in the sense that MPLS forwarding decision can differ from those of IP routing. For example, using destination and source address to route flows to same destination differently and therefore providing some sort of traffic engineering. يعني لو كانت عندنا two traffic flows going to the same destination, let's call it D, and there is one flow, flow number one going from A to D, then flow one هو عبارة عن all buckets going from A to D, وعندنا flow two which is the traffic going from B to D. We know that in IP routing, the traffic going from A to D and the traffic going from B to D will go along the same path at certain point. The traffic will aggregate at a certain router, and from this router till the end, okay, they will follow the same path because bucket forwarding is based on the IP destination address. Therefore, this is the case in IP routing. However, in MPLS, bucket forwarding can be based on both source and destination. For example, an MPLS router or a label switched router that receives traffic from A and receives traffic from B, and the traffic is to be forwarded to D, will decide, for example, that the traffic from A to D, which is flow 1, will go along certain path. Let's call it path 1. While the traffic going from B to D will go along a different path. This is called, for example, path 2. Now, this provides some sort of traffic engineering in the sense that we are performing some load balancing, for example, to distribute the load along different links. Or for privacy reasons, for example, we need to route the traffic from A to D along P1 while route the traffic from B to D along P2. Also, it provides the advantage of rerouting flows quickly if link fails. For example, this router, which is again a labeled switch router or MPLS router, in case of path failure or link failure, it can reroute traffic quickly. For example, if there is a failure along the path from the router to D, then the router can forward the traffic of flow 2 along path 1. And this is important in certain applications such as voice over IP in order to ensure there is no interruption or no discontinuity in the application itself. The idea is illustrated here where we compare IP routing and MPLS routing. In IP routing, path destination is determined by destination address alone. Again, here the traffic from R6 to A and the traffic from R5 to A will go along the same path, starting from router 4 to router 2 to, let's call this, router 7. Because again, each router will forward the traffic to the final destination, which is A, based on the destination address. And as we know, all routers will have or will decide to forward the traffic, whether it is coming from R6 or R5, along the same outgoing interface. However, in MPLS, this MPLS router will decide to forward each traffic flow in different way. For example, the traffic coming from R6 will go along the first path, which consists of routers R4, then R3, then R7, and then to the destination. Again, let's call this R7. While the traffic from R5 will be forwarded along the path that consists of R4 to R2 and R7. Therefore, in MPLS routing, path to destination can be based on source and destination addresses, and this also again provide fast reroute based on pre-computed backup routes in case of link failure. In case of failure or attack, for example, on R2, R4 can decide to reroute the traffic going from R5 to A along the path that consists of R4, R3, and then R7. To provide this functionality, MPLS routers or labeled switch routers exchange routing information in a way similar to those used in link state protocol. However, there is a protocol which is considered a modified version of a shortest path first or link state to link state flooding protocol, where it can this modified version carry additional information that include the link bandwidth and the amount of reserved link bandwidth, and perform certain signaling information based on a protocol known as reservation path, the TE signaling protocol, to set up MPLS forwarding and downstream routers. Here we show MPLS forwarding table example, where R7 will advertise that destination A is reachable. It will of course advertise this information to neighboring routers, which are R3 and R2, telling them that A is reachable through this interface, and the datagram should carry a label with value equal to 6. Therefore, the incoming, wherever a label with the a label value equal to 6 and with destination address will equal to A, which is the final address, then the packet will be forwarded along interface 0. Based on this advertisement, both R3 and R2 will add an entry in their tables, okay, specifying that A is reachable through outgoing interface number 1 with respect to R3, and that the label should carry a value that is equal to 6 as specified by R7. Similar thing for R2, it will add this entry indicating that A is reachable through interface 0, which is the interface where the advertisement was received, and the label value that should be carried in the IP datagram should be equal to 6 in order to match the N label value that will be received by R7. Similarly, R3 will propagate this advertisement to R4, and R2 will also propagate the advertisement to R4, indicating that A is reachable through this interface, and therefore A will be added to the table. A is reachable through interface 0 of R4, and telling R4 that the label value should be equal to 10. Therefore, the out label value specified by R4 should be equal to 10. Similarly, as R2 advertised this information to R4, R4 will add an entry indicating that A is reachable through interface 1, and that the out label value should be equal to 10 in order to match the in label value that will be received by R2. Now, if an IP datagram is going from R5 to A, okay, then R4, which is an MPLS router, will assign a label for this datagram, which is equal to 8, and then will be forwarded along interface 1 as indicated in the table. When reached R2 will inspect its own table and find out that the in label is equal to 8 and the destination is A. Therefore, the out label should be equal to 6 and the outgoing interface will be 0. Therefore, the label now will carry the value 6 and it will go along the interface, interface 0. When received by this router, it will find out that this datagram, which is going to destination A and carries label value equal to 6, should be forwarded along interface 0 and it will reach A. However, a datagram that is coming from R6 will be assigned a label value that is equal to 10 as indicated in this table and will be forwarded along interface 0. Here the datagram will carry label 10 and go to destination A. Based on this information and based on the information found in the table, the label will be, or the datagram will be assigned a new label value which is equal to 6 and will be forwarded along interface number 1 as indicated in the table. Again, based on this information, since the datagram carries label value equal to 6 and will be forwarded to interface number 0. Section 6.6, data center networking. Here we provide generic overview about data center networks and mainly for big companies such as e-business firms, example Amazon, content servers such as YouTube, Akamai, Apple, Microsoft, search engines and data mining companies such as Google. Such data center networks usually include tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of machines or hosts closely coupled in a close proximity. Within the same location, we are talking about very large number of hosts altogether. This complex environment poses several challenges, which are due to having multiple applications. Here we are talking about media streaming applications. We are talking about social networking applications. We are talking about search engines. We are talking about e-commerce applications. And each application serves massive number of clients. Therefore, it's important to efficiently manage these networks by introducing load balancing, by avoiding processing bottlenecks, by avoiding processing delay, by avoiding networking bottlenecks and data bottlenecks within the network. Here we show the general architecture of a data center network. The network is connected to the internet through the border router, which is connected internally to access routers. And each access router is connected to tier one switches in the first level. And each tier one switch is connected to multiple tier two switches at the second level. And again, tier two switches are in turn connected to top of rack switches, where each switch is mainly allocated for a server rack. It's mainly a cabinet with several servers. يعني عندنا كابينة فيها مجموعة من السيرفرز. Okay, connected to the top of the rack switch. واللي هو بدوره الآن connected to tier 2 switch. وtier 2 الآن get service from tier 1. And tier 1 get service from the access router. And the access router from the border router. And then it can reach the internet. نشوف الآن component مهمة جدا وهي load balancer. اللي موجود الآن connected to tier 1 switch number 1 and tier switch number 2. الهدف الرئيسي من اللود بالانسر هو يعني to distribute اللود على السيرفرز within the internal network. When a request is received, it will be forwarded initially to the load balancer. The load balancer will decide where to send the request based على اللي هو اللود مونيتورنج available at the load balancer. It knows قديش اللود موجود على كل سيرفر, بالتالي بده يوزع اللود على السيرفرز بطريقة الآن متساوية وفي أوفير إلى حد ما. فبقرر الآن أنه هذا request will be satisfied from this server or from this server. Once the request is forwarded to a certain server, the result will be sent back to the load balancer and the load balancer will send it back to the client. In a way where the internal communication is hidden from the external user. برضو الداتا سنتر provide rich interconnection among switches and racks in order to increase the throughput between racks. نشوف في عندنا a lot of interconnections بين switches. لها سببين, عندنا اللي هو increasing the throughput من ناحية by having multiple routing paths and increasing reliability via redundancy. يعني لو صار في مثلا failure على switch معين لأي سبب كان, بيكون في عندنا switch ثاني backup أو مجموعة switches ثانية that will perform the same operation. لو صار برضو عندنا failure على مثلا على راك كاملة أو على جزء من الراك أو على سيرفر فيها, برضو في عندنا other servers that will provide the same content. فموضوع ال reliability, موضوع redundancy, موضوع مهم جدا في ال data centers in order to guarantee ال service delivery without any interruption.